Sorry, spilling all over.
Would like to welcome you all to this third and final dialogue. It's entitled on music or the combat of Cronus and Aeon. I'm taking over for Paolo to chair the session at the latest hour. Well, although I wish I had an hour to be fair, so bear with me. But hopefully, I don't have to do anything. And we have these excellent people here who I think will have lots of interesting things to say on the relations between Deleuze and music. This will be our talking stick, so whoever has the mic in his or her hands is allowed to speak, and it's not because people wouldn't be able to hear us, but because of the recording, because these mics appear not to be sufficient to properly record all of our voices. So this is hopefully a way to regulate the discussion, and hopefully a lively discussion that will happen in this session. First of all, quickly introduce us by naming their names. We begin there with Deborah Walker, Edward Campbell, Pascal Giton, Brian Hals, and Martin Schertinger, and I again, and Vincent Milgrave. I think the best way to open this discussion is by taking the title of the first section of a review of a book by Brian on Edward's book as a kind of a statement or a hypothesis, perhaps, or a point for discussion. And that title is "All Music is Deleuzian." And I think the most interesting part is that Deleuzian is between quotation marks. So, Brian, perhaps you could elaborate on the quotation marks in the assertion that all music is Deleuzian. You're welcome.
You know, I should have reread that before coming.
I had it here, so
All music is Deleuzian. I'm not sure I thought too much about those scare quotes. I guess in the sense that I don't want to call music anything, really. But if you're going to I guess what I meant by those quotes was that Deleuze, as a metaphysician, as a philosopher of process, there's no exclusive or particularly Deleuzian music, because you can theorize any music using concepts from Deleuze, and that was, I guess, the point of my critique, which was kind of a cheap shot on a certain level, but on another level, it was meant to be provocative, and it points to a definite blind spot, I think, in Deleuze studies, particularly with music, where there's so much attention paid to modernist composers, European white composers. And somehow the way this group of composers talks about music and thinks about music, it's all part of this genre of European intellectualism that is fine, but it also reflects a blind spot in Deleuze himself, and it's something that needs to be worked on. I guess that's what I meant to say.
I need a talking stick, else I'm not allowed to speak. Okay, Edward, since this was a review of your book, what is your take on the assertion that all music is delusion, or perhaps only modern music is delusion, and perhaps by extension, only real music is modern music?
Well, I suppose it was a relatively short book, and I think I did cover quite a lot of different musics in it, both from my own work on different musics and also from taking into the book a variety of musics. I think Brian was unconvinced by the moments of ethnomusicological comics or likewise jazz, but there was an attempt to show that different musics are modern, but for me, I must admit, my biggest problem with Brian's statement was it seemed as kind of crazy, to be honest, as saying all philosophy was Deleuzian. That's kind of what I thought about it. Now, clearly, you can relate Deleuze to any philosophy, and equally, I think Deleuze has something to say to any music, just like you can take a Hegelian view of any music. So it wasn't a case of doing that. The important thing about focusing on the modernist repertoire, if you like, I suppose it was partly because it's the music I work on, but I suppose I partly work on it because it's music that I do think is really molecular. I suppose all of the musics I kind of privileged were musics which I thought were radically molecular. And I kind of thought that some of the examples that were maybe taken up in the critique were less molecular. And while I thought they were worth talking about, I didn't think in a short book that they offered such radical options that for me were in the Delorean spirit.
Right, so my point would be, well, maybe there needs to be some more work done to rethink some things that we may not immediately see as radical, so that our thought becomes radicalized in relation to the Beatles or music from wherever. I mean, I think of that music as needing to be radicalized in the way we think about it, and not so domesticated or assumed to be that way. So.
Sure. Sorry. As a composer, Pascal, I saw your presentation yesterday, and you seem to be very much inspired by Deleuzean thinking, and the way you compose your music is really, let's say, approached, at least in the examples that you showed and let us listen to, were, entrenched and through and through almost. And Deleuze, do you think that there is a certain kind of music that, well, for lack of a better word, deserves that label, or is it something else? The label Deleuze.
Well, I think that as I will talk, because I've been working very long time with Deleuze, so I talk as a kind of a pupil or familiar. And Deleuze would never talk in general. He would ever talk in a particular when something or someone has to do something for his own reason. And to a certain point, Deleuze is interested when it starts to be a kind of a singular or a matter that brings something to the idea of a condition of life, condition of being, condition of acting. So I think that it's in any music that such a thing can eventually happen. But that it's not given to any kind of music either. And so here we are in front of a behavior. We are in front of, I wouldn't say ethic, because it's maybe too moralistic. And but it means something that engages a kind of movement, and which is touching the point of invention, and it's not invention like being a big inventor. It can be small things, it can be stylistic matter, and how a body, a mind, and a group of person invent a way of life, a way of feeling. I think that's the matter of Deleuze. And concerning me, then, I cannot pretend, because it's not me to say it, but I cannot pretend that it's delusion. I think it would be a little forced to say that any music is a delusion, because no. Some music can have a kind of resonance with a way to avoid a certain kind of repetition, low-level repetition, and can have something to do with some intensive manner. I didn't answer, maybe.
Sorry?
Maybe je n'ai pas répondu à sa question.
And as a performer, I'll address you as a as a performer, well, at least now, for now, how is there, do you think there is, well, it's a bit of a twofold question. First of all, do you think indeed that the music inspired directly or indirectly by Deleuze affords a certain way of expression? And a second question, it's perhaps even more interesting, do you think there is a Deleuzean way of interpreting any kind of music?
Of course, I encountered some of the concepts of Deleuze working with Pascal, and specifically we worked on two different pieces for cello that had very two different ways, so I can more speak about the piece. And I should say that one thing that I found it was the different finding new ways, new system to rethink how it could be work on a piece. Like the first piece that we worked on was really compose and write, but there were some aspects that we had really to work together, and it is about expression, it is about the quality of movements. And the second piece that we worked together was more a different way of working, was on a tuned cello, microtonal tuned cello. And for example, that thing particularly was changing completely a system, changing an object, that changed also my reactions on an instrument. So this particularly for me was really changing what is all the habits of interpretation and all the knowledge that I thought I had, and completely leaving a certain kind of knowledge and to find a new territory, a different one. Kind of somebody this morning talked about invisible body, and I thought that was really a very nice way to see what is behind interpretation and behind what we do. Another difference that I encountered was while we were working on this second piece, Curse Capture, Pascal was organizing a real lecture of the Curse Mons of Félix Guattari. It was a series of events, a series of meetings with different talks and performances, and many different people came from the artistic world, but also from politics and from social works. And all those people were inspired and worked also with Guattari or with Deleuze. And the artists also were coming and performing in a kind of context where it was really very different from a concert. And it was more like a space that was shared and where everybody could talk and say something. And so there was no separation between the space of the performance and the space of the listening. And all these aspects, I don't know if I really answered to what you asked, but all these aspects were for me something really new. I found it through this work that we did together, and this is going to affect also the other project that I'm working on, that are not specifically Deleuze or not specifically, but it's for me especially a change of a system and a change that happens in the body in a dynamic way.
Well, speaking of one concept that you introduced in your answer, which is affect, which for me personally I think is one of the let's say most potentially productive concepts of the Deleuze, but at the same time it is a concept that, for instance, Martin has some interesting And well, I don't know whether or not there are doubts, but at least you're kind of wary or suspicious about that concept. And could you perhaps elaborate on your, let's say, doubts or suspicions regarding affect and why you think you shouldn't just perhaps take it at face value, perhaps that isn't even possible?
Okay. Doubts, actually outright dismissals.
Oh, here goes.
So, should I recap a little bit?
So the
talk that I just gave was called Anti-Oedipus. So in some sense, reclaiming dialectics in the face of this sort of hybrid Deleuzianism that seems to have captured the imagination of the humanities in recent years. So that is more or less where I was locating it. And I was looking at particularly the examples that folks who consider themselves sort of Deleuzian brought forth as these moments of affect, and then sort of looking at them a little bit more closely, and were they really these pre-personal intensities, and was the definition of what they counted as being philosophically really correct? And my answer was more or less that they were not, right? So a drastic sort of experience of a cracked voice of Hetna or something like that turned out to be deeply, deeply mired in Gnostic information, and then at the same time, a prioristically and a posterioristically as well, sort of recouped by that in a way that, in the case of Ben Hetna singing Walter's voice, sort of recapitulating the text of the very music drama that it was supposed to be veering off of, and so on and so forth. So I was just looking and being critical of, you know, to what extent was affect a useful concept here. I also noticed that sport and music often make their appearance in this literature on affect, and that's interesting, because if affect is the non-signifying potentiality, the incipient and so on, why is it the most signifying animal that produces affect, particularly in its artificial games, such as sport and such as music? But that's, you know, neither here nor there. One thing I wanted to maybe reflect on was why, and I could just sort of pivot the conversation, unless you want to take it somewhere else at this point, but why I think this question arises about where is, you know, what is Deleuze music and so on and so forth. And there's something very obvious is that maybe just needs to be mentioned, is that, you know, that that music takes up considerable residency in Deleuze's writings, right? I mean, it seems to play a philosophical role, and it seems to, you know, produce some forms of thought, but as it turns out, it does Thousand Plateaus, and I'm repeating what you know, but it's quite, you know, it's very Catholic and capacious in what it takes on board as organizers of thought. You know, there's a lobster pincer and a Dogon egg, you know, Africa and so on and so forth, but there's never any, like, sort of sounds of nature, nor sounds of Africa or anything like that. So there's a way in which it's constrained, it's sounds of modernism, right? It's Berio, it is Debussy, it is Ravel, and above all, Boulez. Right? The Boulez takes up a prominent role in this. And that's the reason why one is sort of wondering, what's going on? What is a minor music and so on? Why can't it be something else? Why can't it be jazz? And I think that's what prompts the suspicion. So just to, I think, contextualize why this becomes an issue is also, like, what is the philosopher doing? And what does he expose himself to? He's pretty, like, you know, freewheeling about taking other things. Why has he still got this weird constraint in the musical sense? And so I guess that's just to contextualize why that question actually matters. And I wouldn't mind continuing that, but it's time for me to pass it back to someone else.
Sure.
I don't know what the rules are for the dialogue since this one. For me,
I'm sure you're free to.
But I have to hand you the microphone then, because else you're not allowed to speak.
I was already intrigued by your use of the concept, and I was reminded that Deleuze makes a fundamental distinction between affectio and affectus, and neither of them can be translated as affect. So affectio and affectus represent different stages of mixing bodies. One is the most primitive, elementary form, which lacks everyday issue. It's just like a sensation of the sun on my body, warming my skin, since you love skin so much. And then the slightly higher order is the lowest form of knowledge. I always forget the distinction of which one is which. But one is the lowest form of understanding when one has a notion of what is the source. Well, it struck me that your lecture seems to be glossing over this difference and using the lowest form.
Who are you talking to? You?
I recognize myself.
I don't know. I'm just sorry. Yeah, technical
perfection, yeah.
So that, you know, the
when
you speak of wisdom, what are you used to, what is your first name? Is pausing for a moment, etc. I mean, these are equivalents of the sun. Feeling good on my skin. And so I would actually, because Deleuze was not interested in the lowest form of bodies being exposed to one another, but I think that if you want to translate that to kind of popular American culture and you know, different examples that you were citing for, maybe the notion of the cliché would be useful here. It's obviously a visual concept that a cliché is when you see with another, with the cliché, or it's a contact lens. It's the contact lens that sees for you. Therefore, you are really not in contact with whatever is affecting you. It's already structured by a pre-programmed software or whatever it is. And I was wondering, could it be not possible to think of these, what you call effects, a kind of cliché effects, that really lack the force of the encounter of bodies, because there is something standing in between. You call it ideology, you call it construction, etc. So I'm trying to say, to critique Deleuze as if his notion of effect was equivalent to the contact lens of effect, I think it's fundamentally misplacing your argument. You might be very, very right about Masumi and all the others who I failed to read, but I think when Deleuze says that art is effect, he's not talking about the song forming on his skin.
Well, I guess you would like to
science
react, but I saw Pascal shaking her head as well, so I will give her the mic in a minute as well. But
so,
yeah, perfect, yeah.
First?
Yeah, yeah, because the question was directly asked to you.
I mean, that's interesting. Yeah. So the one is the sort of the sun and the skin thing.
Alpha game?
It might be. I don't know.
It's off.
Yeah, it's off.
It says on, so either the battery is there.
Should we forget it?
Sounds a bit, well, we'll just continue without a thing and hopefully these mics will pick up enough sounds for it.
Okay, so the distinction is, and you could have finished the sentence and said, you know, on the one hand he's not talking about the sun on your skin, and nor is he talking about the cliché which is already structured and so on and so forth. It's somewhere in between those two things. Here's where I would invite, okay, well, affectus. But you didn't tell us what it was, so maybe I can ask you. So the first thing is that I wasn't actually talking about Deleuze at all, okay? I was talking about the effect of Deleuze in the early 21st century. Why has Deleuze gripped our imagination now? And what is the version of Deleuze that is playing itself out now? So that was the question I was addressing myself to. So I'm not really a close reader.
You need to admit that the version of Deleuze is circulating at that part of the world really is not
Maybe we can see what Jesus really meant, but we can decide what Jesus really meant. But on the other hand, so this distinction is what I would be saying is that this sun on your skin thing, which seems to play a role because Masumi's examples are a little bit in between. They are not, in fact, sun on your skin, and they're not either the fully formed cliché. He is saying there's a sort of physiological split that happens when one is sort of in this incipient moment. Which is out of line, disaligned with the interpretive moment, right? So this is what he's kind of after, but that's what I was doing. And so I'm saying that the cliché is in fact already in the so-called, this is to summarize, the cliché is already present in the most non-cliché-seeming, sun-oriented experiences. That's what my claim was. That in fact it's sort of coiled up, the Gnostic, as it were, or the knowledge-based is already coiled up within. So when Malachi doesn't move and Banky move ducks, right? This is not some kind of cliché exactly. It is a reading that takes place within a moment of shared intensity And that is how Masumi works it. Now, what Deleuze really meant, maybe I can invite you to give me an example of affectus, and then we'll see where we're at. What's that?
Masumi, full of cliché.
Well, no, you said it.
It's not very
No, no, but let me just stop for the sake of conversation. Let me invite you to give me an example that would stand well for, that we've got something to talk about, for affectus, which is not in between, it is not the sudden, it is not the cliché. Can you give me an example of this?
If you know the source, what do you must really understand? So, for example, when you are meeting Pierre on the street and you are here with this horrible sensation, you realize that my relationship to Pierre is the source of my problem. And I should be going away. The sun is in this, you know, the lizard is sitting on the head of the lizard, sitting on the stone and warming his body. That is the most primitive form of the affectus. It is nothing but the encounter of two bodies. But when there is a modicum of understanding of where this sensation arises, or what is the source of it, then that already has a germ of an idea.
I would like, as we are in, confronted in a art situation, and if I talk as an artist point of view, I saw that how many artists are interested in reading Deleuze, because moreover the figure or metaphor, over metaphor, there is something that talks without mediation, which are something with strength, with forces, I don't know which word in English, and that works very straightly. And it's not something that has to be mediated with in-between consideration in an artistic point of view, or in the point of science that put us in movement, science that affect us because they bring, they touch us, they touch and they bring something to do. Otherwise, we are not touched, which is not a problem. We can be not touched, it's not a... but the, all the matter of Deleuze is what touched us and for what movement in mind and production. And in an artistic point of view and musical, I think that we must keep the idea that affect is having a role.
Is the difference in the word you feel what you feel, sensitivity, it's not to do with skin or with sound or whatever, it's something that you are deeply moved inside and there's a difference of degree in your psyche. That's affect. That's the definition of psychomantics also.
Non, ce n'est pas anti-Deleuze, la psychanalyse, il y en a plein dans différences et répétitions. Différence et répétition is very...
I think Brian wanted to add.
No, I'm not saying affect doesn't exist.
Brian.
Can I turn it?
Sure.
Have a little turn here. sorry.
Effective one.
Well, you know, just back to Deleuze and mm-hmm. music and yeah. Deleuze, and something that Pascal said about low-level, what did you say, low-level rhythm or something?
I don't remember.
Low-level rhythm?
Low-level ritual.
Yeah,
it was Rengaine. Yeah.
And so that's, you know, that's the point, I think, where, you know, that's my problem with Deleuze and Boulez. With this idea of the striated time as being what meter or rhythm or whatever you want to call it is, and to me that immediately puts onto a low level just about all music that's ever been created in the history of human music making, and yes, I mean because it all has rhythm and meter. It's, I mean, unless I've misunderstood.
No, yes, because I was not in a psychological matter or meaning. Mm-hmm. So I think that if we want to talk about Deleuze, we could not put kind of immediate colored interpretation, and try before to understand, for instance, what brings, what possibilities brings Deleuze to work. For instance, in ethnomusicology, or different ways of different culture music, and there is some African music that I brought and that are quoted, and also that are have whole meaning in the use of small variation. There is a musicologist, ethnomusicologist, very well known in France, whose name is Jean During, who wrote in the book we edited recently. I make not the publicity, but here it is. So in this book there is a very beautiful text about how During, as a specialist of Azimineur music and Indian music, find in Deleuze the way to talk in non-hierarchized function and distribution of differences. And he says that in the anthropologic field and musicology normalized in a kind of a still structured structuralist or post-structuralist ways, don't allow him to get into the specific intensive manner of this music, and that Deleuze help him. And I think that Deleuze is not a musicologist. He doesn't have to say, to my point of view, as I saw him, he just asked people to give him from the point that what he needs in his concept. So he find, at one moment he find Boulez, and Boulez is useful for something, that it's a distribution that is not transcendent. There is nothing that is going to come from outside. It's just what we do. What we do on a plane that is not completely empty, but who has direction. So I don't want to talk too much. So I think it's rather tools than attitude or psychologic position. Sorry.
Yeah, but it's basically also what we said in their book. What's philosophy? Yeah? It's a toolbox, basically. You use your the toolbox.
Toolbox. For, yeah. Yes.
Yeah, I just wanted to go back onto Brian's point about rhythm, because. You know, looking, someone this morning was talking about Brahms, you know, and already at the end of the 19th century, Brahms playing over the phrase, because the music's so easily assimilable from a tonal point of view, we miss the subtlety already within Brahms's music. And it is a Deleuzian insight, the way that Wagner contracts and expands phrases. But these are not things which that most listeners seem to have recognised within the music, like... For me, and I'm coming out modernist, card in hand here, there's something that listening, and I don't just mean modernist, but listening to all new music and listening to other musics really changed the way we listen to the music of the past, really changes the way that I listen to the music of the past. So in a certain sense, a music which is much more self-consciously, that's playing with time, that's much more focused theoretically on the play with time, in a certain way opens up the late romantic repertoire to us in a way that I don't think was quite the case. But then you look to the struggles of someone like Boulez in the middle part of the century, to have time in music recognised as something really important in itself. I mean, it's a moment when people like Gisèle Brillet are writing major theses on time. And that sort of thing wasn't really happening within music. The kind of notion that I know that nobody really holds to this, and that the examples from Brahms and Wagner showed that the practice was already in advance of the theory. But there comes a point when composers really realise that temporality is something that can be played with much more freely than has gone before. Now, all of these musicians, all of these philosophers are just human beings like the rest of us with their own tastes, you know, so Deleuze has his tastes, we may agree with them or disagree with them. Boulez, in his published writings, is very intransigent, it seems at times, in terms of the things he likes and the things he doesn't like, just as Adorno is before. But on the other hand, that kind of thing is a real danger of wanting then to not recognise where they had actually really productive ideas on the basis that maybe they had very serious prejudices as well. You know, just on the rhythm point of view, I mean, when you read in the Cage correspondence and Boulez and Cage are laughing at Dizzy Gillespie, I love jazz myself, but it's partly why dealing with certain repertoires that are kind of, some experiments are kind of more radical than others. Now, that doesn't make good music necessarily because something's a more radical experiment, but it does seem to me that Deleuze is a radical philosopher, and if you want to make connections with Deleuze, then if you want to talk about literature or music, then it's going to have to match up in terms of radicality.
And I think the repertoires you're talking about, I mean, they're all European, and they all have lots and lots of people talking. There's lots of words around it, you know, lots of theory and talk, and I think, yes, maybe this is radical in this way, but there's other kinds of radicality, even with, is that a word? Radicality. I'm thinking of this. Has anyone seen this movie? This is a German film about a producer who goes around recording music. It's pretty recent. Yes, what is it? Yeah, anyway, there's this great scene where it's some very famous German cellist playing with harmonica. What is this thing called? Accordion, yeah. A Brazilian, accordion player who's, he plays, Brazilian music, tango or whatever, and he's, he makes a point that he's never been to school. He doesn't know anything about these high-minded ideas. But there's this wonderful scene where they're playing this tango, and he has to teach the cellist how to play, rhythm without going like this, and to me, maybe very, very subtle, but it's incredibly radical on a certain level, and it doesn't have to do with words. He didn't say anything. He had to make her listen until she finally got it, and I think on that level, maybe the words have too much power in terms of music in some situations.
Sorry, without wanting to monopolize, but I mean, when I read the review, because I received it without a name, but I thought it's an American. And then I honed it down to three people I thought might have written it, two of them are here. Because I must admit, I kind of felt there was a kind of little American thing there. And I was interested just going to look at a different publication, which I think you were both in, maybe not. It was a publication recently about European philosophy and music, in which all of the contributors were American. And I saw a very interesting disjunction really there by American philosophers in America writing about philosophy and music had to come to Europe to do it. So, I mean, I'm just, you know, understand, I think there's this, in my book, for example, I do talk about Carter. If Deleuze had spoken about Carter like he speaks about Boulez, would we be having the same conversation, only it wouldn't be anti...
Cage.
Hmm? Or Cage, yeah.
I'm in the European diaspora.
Yeah.
Not to do...
I'm not accusing you of anti-Europeanism. It's usually the other way around. I'm just asking, though, it's that whole thing about America forging a tradition and the fact trying to break roots from these from old Europe.
Well, I'm not going to deny that.
Talking about the book that I edited, I think.
Yes, I am.
Music in Contemporary Philosophy, great title, isn't it?
It is. I'm giving you
we wanted something fancy, but like Google machining was like, no way. It's got to be like. But yeah, I'm not American. I was the editor. Juan Bellum, I am. This is just because you're at a conference and like a bunch of like-minded people do stuff, and it's like, oh, let's turn it into a publication. And Routledge asked us, Maybe it's symptomatic of something. Maybe we should get into identity politics. And it's twice now that I've become
I want to finish. I want to say something about the reference to Boulez, to close maybe that. It's that Boulez wrote that book, Pensez la musique aujourd'hui, in 1965, and he himself never applied it. So it was a kind of not exercise, but something he burst out, because it was to give a time space without tension, without rules pre-structured, even if it was structuralized. So it has to be understood like a kind of tool of thinking for Deleuze, where he builds and takes things here and there, and generally all the connection he makes with himself in a linguistic or here or there, generally specialist says that he is wrong the way he takes it, because he always put it in a way that is serving his own work. So he's not talking about music, never. He's always making his own concepts. And for that, he takes any flower and stones that he finds in his way and that could be useful in a kind of operating way, which is not to be in an identified manner. So it's not a matter of the style of music. And it's not a matter if it's a European or not.
What about another composer that Deleuze was referred to often, which is also interesting from, let's say, an identity point of view, namely Edgar Varèse, a Frenchman who emigrated to America. Thus, the way Deleuze uses his work, or misuses, abuses, whatever word you may want to use, does that pose similar problems, or is that another case altogether? Or don't you have any opinion on it at all? It's also a possibility, of course. I saw you refer to it at several pages in your book. I just checked it.
But yeah, well, Martin asked me what I thought was an interesting question yesterday about Deleuze and music outside of Europe. But I know Pascal has interesting things to say about the actuality of Deleuze's class and his exposure to other cultures. But I suppose for me, I think probably Varèse more than Boulez is actually the notion of the cosmic musician. Mm-hmm. That Boulez is more useful to him conceptually. I think he's closer to Berio in terms of liking music. But I think probably in terms of a kind of radical music that really takes off in a line of flight, I think it probably is Varèse more than anyone that he thinks has done that. That's only my opinion.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think it's back to that point about what is the music that he uses. And I don't actually have some sort of inherent problem that is not as sort of universal in his thought and so on. Although I do find it interesting, just mapping the conversation, I invite everybody to consider, at which point do we treat something like a toolbox, and at which point do we have to read the thing correctly, right? Because both of those vibes are going on simultaneously in this room, and I just think it's an interesting sort of injunction, like, oh, this is not what Boulez meant, or oh, this is not what Deleuze meant, but other times it's like, oh, I can take bits and pieces for my own. Anyway, just something to think about. But in terms of what he does use, I do think it is interesting. You can kind of get a sense of the conceptual shift when you do look at what the original thing is. So if we look at, you know, the diagonal as a concept, or smooth and striated space, and so on, and how it functions in Boulez, and then how it functions in Deleuze, and there's this great swerve away from, and see what happens. What does thought do when it makes that kind of shift? And when I raised this with Boulez himself on the smooth and the striated, he was like, it was a technical, you know, term. And by smooth, he just meant, you know, the instrument, you sound it out until it's been through its full resonance and so on, and then that's the timing, that's the cue to come in with the next term. It's literally what he said when I was in a conversation with him. Maybe when you read the original text, it's more complicated than what he said later. But in a sense, he was fending himself off from the great escalations, these sort of philosophical maneuvers that Deleuze had made, which he thought were enjoyable and so on and so forth, but had nothing to do with what he was doing and what have you. But it's interesting to see how the smooth then becomes a kind of smooth space, a kind of plane of consistency, which is a sort of flat ontology in Harman. You know, these things have interesting genealogies, and so many of them. And the one I brought up for you was, you know, the Berio's connection to Africa, which then is being read by Boulez, by Berio in a certain way, which is then read by Deleuze in a certain way. So he hears certain passages in Berio as being these sort of the diavisual and the sort of heterophony as being kind of interspace between the autonomous, atomized, solipsistic individual and then the altogether two unified crowd, and that there's something else going on. And it's interesting, and then that actually then later becomes very important conceptually for other anthropologists and so on. So there is a weird link back to sometimes spaces that are non-Western.
But I mean, I think Pascal will have interesting things to say on this, but I don't think Boulez has been quite upfront, really, in saying that it's just, I mean, he's at a stage in his life latterly when he's not so interested in these things, but looking at the situation of the 50s with the kind of micropolyphony of Ligeti, looking at the divisi strings of Xenakis, Vishnegradsky, whom Pascal Pitton is much more qualified to speak on, but Boulez had performed in these microtonal pieces with four pianos in the 50s. This was a very deep reflection. His letters to Cage with great frustration about the difficulties of actually making quartertone writing audible or the practicalities of achieving it, which he tried several times. So it's probably a bit disingenuous of him to talk about this later on in such a disembodied way as if it was simply the most general principle. Other people were making categorizations, taxonomies, cartographies of pitch spaces at that time. And I know we can say it's inadequate to talk about pitch separate from timbre. You find it in Schoenberg, you find it in Dusapan, but maybe Boulez is one of the closest to that thought of the embodiment of pitch and timbre together. But nevertheless, if we're addressing the history of music, most of it has been dealt with in a pitch-type way, even to the point I tried to make yesterday about tonality being imposed as a colonial tool. Sorry.
So, no, many things. I even think that, Boulez played Vishnegradsky music in 1945. And he read that his book, his Think, Thought About Ponsonority. And I think that Smooth and Street come from there. So it come from a Russian, from the beginning of the 1910 years with the futurist thinking. But in Boulez's problematic, there is also the crossing with Stockhausen and not Stockhausen, but the first machines that give the electronic sound, which is beating before having tone. And then coming on a tone. So this is how our physiologic system allows to hear what is before a tone, that means beating, vibrate speeds, and when it becomes regular periodicity. And all this thinking, all this matter, have something to do with a representation that exists in philosophy. I think that the Stoician tradition always put a difference between how we may think a plan and how reality is not in fact pre-existing, is not existing. The virtual is what we do. It's not behind us. It's not somewhere in a complete existing hole. We have to be in a cut. We have to be a coupure. We have to cut things to make happen our mind and our consciousness and our doing. More consciousness is not very important for Deleuze. Our way to do. And if we want to do freely, we must not have models, prior. We must not have models, we must not have a rule that would be already there, and we must not have tension, function, and materials that are already structured. That's all how it looks for any way to struggle that.
How is that possible?
What?
To not have anything structured or pre-existing in order to create.
It's how you give the work. The work is only to be done.
I mean, it has to be done. For cellos, you know, you have the cellos pre-given or...
Pre-given? The cello is a story.
Okay.
No? No.
Okay, maybe I'm misunderstanding you.
Well.
No, but maybe from the, sorry, just... The cello is...
There we go.
And about models, it's just like, I think you have to erase something in a moment. There's really, I think... there's this act that to go in this direction to kind of try to separate yourself from the structures that it's a conscience of the structures that you didn't have before, and then it's kind of trying to erasing them and to build something different and creating new relationships.
But you still have, you know, 10 hands.
Of course.
10 hands. you know, it's a show, you don't mind.
In the old days, they only wanted 11. But actually, on the imminent, I think that's one of the achievements of Deleuze, right? Is to bring in this concept of the imminent and no longer the transcendent. Things are not so law-like, they're sort of coordinated, things are more capacities than causes, etc. But I actually want to say, now, when we look at this translation of something in Boulez into Deleuze, we see that, in fact, I think that Deleuze is a little bit more the transcendentalist than what than Deleuze will make of him. In other words, if you go back to the diagonal, the way he got that from was Boulez's elaborations on Webern's achievement in cutting across as a diagonal between harmony and the vertical and the horizontal, the anti-dialectical. He was able to free up the interval as an entity unto itself and so on, and then it could be put into these different serial procedures. However, with Webern, it was very constrained, you know, only interval classes 1 and 2 and 4 in the case of Opus 24, so Adorno thinks it's terrible because the motivics fall off the music like apples from trees, it's not dialectical anymore, and so on. And then Boulez comes along and uses a much more sort of proliferating machine where, through multiplication and slightly more erratic serial production, the algorithm gets more complicated and becomes more opaque. It takes until 1977 or whatever it was for Kobliakov to figure out how the Machtel works and so on. But what's interesting is a big difference between that kind of diagonal and the diagonal as it functions in Deleuze, because it is the algorithm that is hidden and opaque that generates this incredible proliferating machine in Boulez, whereas in Deleuze it's all just and, plus, 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 this with that, it's more patchwork than crochet. And so I'm trying to say there's a little bit of the crochet going on in Boulez that is in fact more prophetic of our times, that Deleuze kind of got it wrong. The flat ontologist risk overlooking how algorithms kind of drive the world just beneath us constantly. And if we are diverted in our immanentism, and we don't need to call algorithms transcendental, but they certainly are opaque and black boxed in a way that makes them quasi-Platonic. They've become new Platonic objects. And I think if we don't take those seriously, we are missing something fundamental about modernity and the contemporary. And so the immanent can be blinding us in some ways to something that might in fact be going on that was in Boulez. And when we think of the way that translation of concept happens from the one thinker to the other, it's symptomatic of precisely this difference. So that's something it doesn't have to have Africa, but there's something about what's going on there in that translation. Sorry,
that's okay.
I think there is something which is also in this matter of a constitution of consistency relating to Simondon and the way things are not in any stable form without kind of vectorization
operation that links things together. So we must think that concept or these tools are not object. I think they are operators, they are vectors, they have to be taken in what they can bring to give shape to something that has a necessity to be felt, thought, done. Art, is it art or is it something else? Is it a concept? So the building is crossing the materiality, what you bring to achieve it, and the materiality and the idea that is coming up with it. You don't have the idea before, you don't have the material before. It's just something that is growing like this. And it's the tools are not ritournelle, diagonal, bloc de sensation. It's not object that you can take like tiroir, drawer, drawer or boxes. It is operator, little machines that gives you not the key, but it gives you the both, an idea of a hole to put the key, and if it fits, it turns. Something that makes you, gives you a possibility to give, to have an operation. And that's to say that sometimes when we read Deleuze, we feel like there is a kind of labyrinthic manner where you come back to a point where we have been already there, but we come there in a different access. And this multiplicity is full of access. Why? Because in fact, there is no object in itself. There is only moving through. So that's...
Yeah, I suppose I was thinking two things. One is about Deleuze. I mean, I suppose since they published the Anti-Oedipus papers, and we saw the letters that were sent and the earlier drafts of that work, I'm just trying to say that similarly, there's a preparation of material. You know, they don't go straight to the text. We don't know where they began and where they finished. We don't know the sequence of the ideas. We don't know how many draftings the whole thing went through. So even the idea that a text by Deleuze or Deleuze and Guattari would simply have come, you know, out from itself immediately, fully grown. And I'm not saying that you're suggesting that, but it's more querying this thing with Boulez. My problem with that, with maybe this, I think that it's an interesting reflection, which you have, although truthfully I'm not persuaded by it. I think it's maybe to buy too much into the Foucault phrase of Deleuze to imagine that, you know, anybody could quite encapsulate a century, and I know you're playing with it. I know you're talking about surface and depth and the fact that we're talking about a flat surface, but nevertheless, there's a problem with the preparation of material in music. No one seems to have problems with visual artists preparing material, and the sense that the preparation of the canvas or whatever surface is used, the notion that the preparation of whatever is applied to the canvas is part of the artwork itself. But nevertheless, with the work of music, there seems to be a problem because I'm not saying this is your position, but there's a kind of naive sense among many in society that music's something intuitive that's just done rather than something prepared. But what I'm saying is it's not necessarily a depth model that's needed, but simply seeing, as Boulez talks about, going from the idea to the artwork as part of the making of the work. There's no depth then, it's simply all part of what becomes of the work. And secondly, maybe a problem with essentializing one moment in production, because it's true, Kobliakov took a very long time to come to that analysis, which he did with just a recording and a score. He didn't have sketches or anything, it's amazing what the guy did. But the fact that with these the people we're talking about, no piece is the same. The fact that, okay, you can look to Ripoll and say you're still dealing with multiplication, but as Jonathan Goldman shows, dealing with lots of the small pieces, they're actually quite easy to analyse, they're not so difficult. It's it's the how do you create an accident is part of the problem for the musician. How do you break out of cliche? And these are simply tools to do that, I would say, rather than a sinister creation. I mean, maybe there is a secret to part of Blue Lies that wants to hide everything. It's certainly been said often enough, but I'm not so sure that looking at it in terms of surface and depth is the only way.
Not sure. I mean, I wonder if the genealogy, I agree, but to elaborate and riff further and trying to pull it back a little bit, isn't it the case that, you know, when Schoenberg begins to work with hexachordal combinatoriality and so on and so forth, he is trying to evade certain sort of like ready-mades, you know, things that come too readily.
Yeah.
It's the sort of inside of, but the fascinating thing, and for Dorno, this was a big deal and a big problem, that he then nets himself into another kind of algorithm, let's call it, and a generator, a machine, an operator, partial, etc. And, you know, who listens to Lemarque and themselves? But maybe, I'm just trying to draw attention to the fact that there might be something at work to make something else happen. Okay, and that as a an image of say smooth space or something like that, I think the patchwork, is this, we've moved in more, and I know I'm not allowed to talk about modern people, but the way in which Deleuze has been used is to draw it into this kind of flat ontology that these are all operators on a sort of plane of equivalence or some sort of plane of consistency, like, you know, the Borges kind of taxonomy, brown dogs, dogs that bark, right down to dogs that belong to the emperor and don't belong in this list and so on. You can just sort of squish that like a synthesizer all into the same level, and the flat ontology of people like Harman or object-oriented ontology or the speculative realists who want to de-hierarchize at all costs, and then we find ourselves, and so we have moved into something flatter than that composition functions. And I think, thank you, Gilles Deleuze, for making that happen. Now, he himself, I think, is much more dialectical. He sort of died in the blue. I mean, why protest so much about Freud, and so on. But I do think that there is something still at stake there that is present in the Boulez. You know, how does one achieve this radical proliferation? And it's almost like you require an Uber system. And I think, you know, this sort of Uberification of our society through algorithms and so on and so forth is something we lose. And so I'm not really interested in what Boulez and Deleuze and so on fundamentally meant. I'm interested in like how inequality is systematically produced in the world. I mean, that's my fundamental. And it turns out that I think the Boulezian sort of picture might give us a better leverage, as I've described it, then to think that there are absent things that people that we are not privy to, black boxes that we need to reckon with, is maybe a better operative metaphor than the one that there's just these machines that are constantly like at work and intersecting and so on, which is true, is it?
Yeah, the question there.
But if you have a multitude of sensible perspective, I mean, it can be black in this direction because the central perspective is on the not place. So it doesn't mean anything to me, flat and dead. And I think that maybe that's what Curtis was trying to say, that it's flat all the time in any direction according to the central perspective.
Yeah. Yeah, but by depth, let's just say dialectic, right? I mean, it's not that I'm saying it's deep, but and then it's flat. But flat, of course, you know, these multi-temporalities, the speed of an algorithm at the same time as the slowness of geological change, all taken into account simultaneously. That's what we mean by flat. It's not that there's just one thing going on. But the dialectic is when the promise of a phenomenon brings down a curse thereby. So when form and content don't line up, and that's more what I mean, I suppose, when I talk about death.
So, I have a couple of questions that I think can wrap into one another. One of them has to do with this idea that if we're focusing on an algorithmic point of view and saying that, well, Webern's algorithm is such, but Boulez's algorithm is more complex, but it's still an algorithm, they're still doing sort of the same things, and eventually it comes down to we're using a Deleuzian way of thinking through music, but we're talking about music, we're talking about a piece of music that is itself kind of an enclosed object. And one of the reasons that I think that talking about Berio with Deleuze is that Berio seems to resist that in the way that he composes music. in that he seems to, what I understand of Berio's music and what I understand of what Berio has talked of, how Berio has talked about music, is that there's these sort of syntactic spaces that are set up, and then at some point along the way that syntax falls apart, and that's kind of, that's built into the way that Berio thinks of the music, and that is itself kind of a becoming molecular or something like that. So that's one thought, and then my other thought is just to ask the panel here what you all think, because we're talking about composition now a lot. How can we think in a Deleuzean kind of way about either improvisation, which some of you know I'm very much into, or performance, or how performance and improvisation kind of fit together? So
One thing I'll say, just a very brief thing, is in response to some of the things you were saying about flat and, you know, these secret magic formulas inside compositions, and this is the thing that kind of is one of my things that I, you know, in music theory, that the whole process of analysis is just to restore the composition to its magic formulas. And, you know, to me, those magic formulas actually don't, well, they have a very uneven relationship with what you actually experience musically. And so I have a issue with this as well. These structures aren't what they claim to be necessarily, and we shouldn't treat them as if they're what even the composer thought they were.
So about performance, I think that what I brought a lot of suggestion in the dealing with it. Because in his book, Taos Moos and the late books, and also a review of Chimère that I gathered two numbers about how Guattari was very involved with the performer and performance idea, and he really gathered there the something which is the transversality. Between conception of time, temporization, the relation with the audience, with the space, with the bodies, and he gives a lot he gives a lot of interest to it. He thinks it's really a form that is that experiment a lot of concept of delusion concept, and I think it's. After, maybe your question could be more precise if you point out some concept in particular.
Well, I would say maybe the thing that is of interest to me from a Deleuzean perspective about music are the things that are themselves proliferating. And the moment of proliferation is the moment of performance, is the moment when the music is actually happening. Mm. And so it would be how we can think about the distinctions from one performance to the next, or one performance interpretation to the next, or the relationship between this sort of reified idea of the composition versus every possible version of that composition that could exist in the world, and how those all kind of intersect with one another. That's no more specific than my first question.
Bruno Nettle wrote somewhere that, you know, he's an ethnomusicologist, and he's talking about improvisation. He said, can we really tell, which is which? And I think the underlying point there is, why are we treating musical experience as categorically, here's a composition and here's an improvisation? Is that really necessary? And I think that made, finding a way to be in the moment musically where that doesn't matter. I think Deleuze helps for that, actually.
Well, I think also the fact that he wrote together with Guattari, and as they said, we are each numerous and we are a lot together. We are, I don't remember exactly how it's translated in English, but that it's the idea of collective, of collectivity in act, that it's not author signature, is not a matter of intellectual property, or it's rather what can be recognizable as sign, as expression. That's the matter always. And if you can work being 3, 4, 5, and you have a kind of involvement in a process, it's
very,
better.
Very quickly, it does turn out that a lot of the neo-Deleuzians, the Abate, Congressional, they're all sort of valorize the live and the performative and so on. So that's one of the opening gambits in Abate's thing. The performance is where it matters, and that's where the drastic can appear and so on and so forth. So there is a well-worn kind of tradition of that. I mean, the question is, to what extent does the work concept in its narrowness and all that actually sponsor and make possible the drastic? Or, you know, otherwise, is it just okay to be, like, thinking about how much the ticket costs for the concert you're watching, and that's perfectly fine? Or is there a way in which something is guided appropriately? And once you have that, you're stuck with the work, and you can't just eliminate it. You know, when Ben Hepner freaks out, that's a problem. Like, what about 99% of the work where he's not freaking out? You know, that's still there, and also in its sheer sort of... Anyway, but so the relationship of work to performance is an interesting one, whether it needs this sort of bifurcated character, or whether it's kind of sheer and... sheer proliferation, machine neck, and so on, again, flatter, or if there's a split world that makes possible these things. You know, and in jazz, of course, I'd say there's a split world too. It's not called the work, but it's something else. And then the question of Berio, I mean, I mentioned one already where Berio sort of said, you know, the heterophony and how he reads that, and then how Deleuze reads that moment in Berio's Coro, and so on. Breaking down machines, I mean, that was Musique Informelle, that was kind of... part of what was going on at the time, and as a conceptual thing, you make music of which you know not what it will be, and so on, or you know not what it becomes, or something, right? The Adorno's formulation, which might capture, but you're going to know much more about
that. No, I think I'm basically suspicious of spontaneity, and I think this is a comment I've heard earlier, but no, basically,
I'm not the only one.
No, I'm suspicious of spontaneity, and I think this is what this is what you find in, you know, many of these composers, and the division of composers into those who plan their works, one of Carter's worked with 3,000 sketches, for example, those who do that, and those who, on the other hand, who, like Dusepin, who says he just writes, he doesn't prepare. When he wrote his opera Faustus, he said he wrote the music and he wrote the libretto from bar to bar. Now, we don't know whether he actually did it that way or not, but then you hear similarities between Faustus and Perelada, which was the opera previous to it, and also the studies. You can see that he was working within a language. Or likewise, Berio. We were talking earlier, Francesca was doing work on Kathy Barbarian, and you can look and say, well, maybe Berio doesn't have all of the sketches, or if he does, he's burned them. But what he did do was certainly experiment with individual musicians, and then takes an individual sequencer make Chemin out of them. You know, so at the end of the day, his own pieces become the sketches for his later ones. So there's still this kind of model there with Berio, albeit he's still intuitive in terms of playing fast and loose with system. But it just has a different place. Likewise with Rheem, who this notion of the palimpsest and rewriting over what he's done. Maybe he hasn't formulated rules, but the previous version of the piece becomes the initial parameter for the next version, if you like.
I wanted to continue this if there's a moment. Yeah, for a second. I just wanted to continue this question because I find myself very aligned with what you're asking about composition, improvisation, and performance. I guess I wanted to, in terms of something more specific, I wanted to kind of put the question of notation out there, because to me that seems to be the black box that's missing from that, and the hinge on which that bifurcation between composition and performance can exist. And I take your point about the text having too much power. It seems that notation functions in exactly the same way. And I know I've been kind of looking at the revolutions in notation that are taking place, and all these kind of other kinds of notation that are being invented. But still, in this context over the last couple of days, it seems to me that notation is very, very central, and kind of we can't so much of what's being discussed can't be imagined without notation, and yet as a concept it's not really arise. Like, I don't think anyone said the word notation so far. And so I'm just wondering, I would personally be very interested to hear the panel's thoughts on, like, what is the status of notation in the things that you're thinking about? Does it remain a kind of like, well, yes, of course, that's a given, there's no need to even discuss it, or is it somehow unstable in the ways that you're talking about?
Score fetishism is at an all-time high. All-time high. That's all I got to say.
It's
hard disabusing people of their fetishes.
I mean, because I'm thinking about things, all of the aspects, when you said the things that proliferate, I think, for me it's not just a specific event like the public event of music, but it's all the things that are not captured in the notation, which doesn't mean that the things can't be captured in notation. I don't want to say such and such can't be captured in notation at all. I just want to say any given notation captures some things and not others. But that means that it should be possible to think about musically, in some way, those things that are not being notated, or things that are not captured, or things that still haven't been figured out how to be captured. That seems quite relevant in some way to these conversations, but it doesn't go there. It stays like, I mean, that we're talking about.
I would say again that maybe do we have to take question in the general frame, or do we have reason to think that for this object of thinking I have, which is the music done by these people, certain people, at one moment somewhere, and what do they need? Do they need to code it or not? Do they need a code then? Which one? And why? Why a code for whom? For what? So it's not a matter of general thing. All what is written is not necessary. All what is improvised will disappear. It's not that. It's all the in between and all the ways of working. And I don't want to be general now myself. And maybe if you talk about a certain kind of music and you have a certain kind of question, what process then will afford the necessity of inventing or not a code, or maybe some code exist and are quite good, since or maybe ancient code are better. It's we don't need to have hierarchies in opposition for what we have to do, because we will have one choice, not everyone. Not every code, every manner together. We will have to choose one. I need no code. Okay.
Or just I do. Playfully to reverse the image a little bit, in the 101 of media studies, when you teach technological determinism, which is to say something that is sort of where the technology has a sort of day-to-day, day-by-day power, where it has determining effects, not in the sense that the car gets me from A to B and transport is improved, but in the sense that the invention of the car produces suburbia in Los Angeles. So it's something unanticipated, but nonetheless somehow an imminent effect from that. Or when the Pope says, you know, the condom produces promiscuity in Africa. That sort of relationship, you know, unanticipated but determined. Notation, music notation is used as the one, is used as a typical example. You introduce notation to standardize something and whoosh, it flowers into polyphony and all sorts of lascivious, terrifying things. And so, in fact, it becomes a kind of proliferating machine all of its own and might, in some sense, be a, you know, more Deleuzean than this, if we only look at it as this terrible, terrible, punctual, but, you know, non-free, non-incipient.
I'm interested to hear Brian's maybe say a bit more about the possibilities for the future. You know, then maybe if you'd like to lie down on the couch and talk about the problems with the score. We're friends. No, but you know, there are no scores, obviously, because they make money. Well, some do. They're sold. Obviously, there are more publishers. People can publish their own scores and all the rest of it, but also the playfulness with notation as well, and this attempt. Now, I, signs that you're looking at the things that are being excluded from the score, and or maybe the basic principle of using some kind of inadequate trace. I don't know, but I'm just, more positively, just wondering about the transmission of music, you know, and how you would envisage that in terms of...
Well, that, I mean, that, how could I? That's the future, but I'm thinking right now about watching a colleague of mine have a sitar lesson with his guru from India that he'd studied with many years, and they came to my university and they did an open lesson, and not a single word was spoken. It was all
doing.
You know, it was all doing, and you know, I think, you know, just thinking about the landscape of academic composition, at least in the U.S., I'm sure in Europe as well, it's extremely dogmatic and limited in on certain levels, and on other levels it's not. But on those certain levels, I think, you know, the score is very much implicated in it, the Augenmusik and the, you know, and just this fascination and fixation on the score. I mistrust that, but I can't really answer your question. I need to think about it more.
But what about your own composition? Are you still score-based?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I just think of the score as a set of directions. Mm-hmm. I'm not that interested in making it look really pretty or... But then again, that's a limitation of mine. We got it.
I guess we need to wrap it up. People are slowly moving. It's kind of a sure sign that we spent enough time discussing the relation between Deleuze and music. I would like to thank all panel members again, and of course also the audience that participated, to meet each other. Next time.